Many thanks, Russ, for this very kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, I know precisely what you're thinking. And admittedly, the soundtrack is quite catchy. But, ladies and gentlemen, it is misleading you.
We don't talk about Bruno, no, no, no. We don't talk about Bruno.
It is only when you watch Disney's latest Encanto that it becomes clear to the people that you must talk about Bruno, as he is the only one that has the gift of telling the prophecy, in your case, the prophecy of what will happen if you do not comply with public procurement rules. The message is therefore, ladies and gentlemen, Bruno CCC. Now, I've been asked to talk with you today about the pre-qualification process. What is that? Well, pre-qualification is an elimination process of candidates. We eliminate candidates against a predetermined set of criteria to ensure that there is a reasonable prospect that each tender that will apply and participate in the tender will be financially strong enough to see the contract through. So the whole idea of weeding out the less strong candidates is to ensure that there will be less chance of a contract failure at the end. Pre-qualification is not required for all procurement. It is mainly used when you're looking for a very particular goods or particular services or a very specific or complex works, very often used and actually a must in capital construction works. Not required at all or not required fully for commodities. So if you're procuring pencils or stationery, sheets or linen, anything of those types of commodity, but the requirement of a pre-qualification is not high. Pre-qualification is all about looking at the tenderer. We're looking at the person. Can she deliver? Does he or she have the ability to do the job? Does he or she have the experience to do the job? And does he or she have the financial strength to do the job? We're looking at the person. Once we are in award stage, which I'm not discussing with you, at award stage we're looking at the tender, which is what will they do for you, and it's all about performance. There is a very strict distinction, or at least there was a very strict distinction in between selection criteria for the pre-qualification and award criteria. They were like fire and ice, not compatible at all, no possible crossover. You could not mix. There was no cocktail possible of selection and award criteria. The big problem, of course, was that at the time you wanted to check if a person could do the job, the tenderer hadn't even thought whom they would propose to do the job, what staff would go forward. So we had a period there of nervousness, a period of case law uncertainty, many, many cases, very interesting stuff, disagreement of speakers. I remember speaking at a conference when someone totally disagreed with me. Absolutely fun. That's over. Ladies and gentlemen, we now have Article 67.2b, which allows, as an award criterion, the qualification of a team assigned to perform the contract, provided that the quality of staff assigned can have a significant impact on the level of performance. Good, we've clarified that. Can I reduce, as a contracting authority, the number of participants? Can I do so? Yes, the directive is very clear. You can, provided you notify the people in advance in the contract notice that you will. it is five, minimum five, maximum five, or minimum five for the restricted procedure, and for the other procedures, minimum three. Now, in reality, because people get very upset about it, you have to make sure that you have a genuine competition. My advice to you is genuine competition means minimum two. The rules of the pre-qualifications, what are the rules? Some people, like engineers, like to see rules and love rules. Me too. The rules are all clearly set out in Article 56 to Article 64 of the classic directive. Very clearly put in there, and immediately when you read Article 56, you realize immediately that you can eliminate candidates provided that. And this is the important element. All the rest is, this is the important one, provided that it is done in an impartial and transparent manner. So the voice you need to listen to is the general principle of procurement law, which are equality, transparency, and proportionality. Proportionality to the subject of the competition. Can a contracting authority ask clarifications when the submissions are in? Yes, 56.4 tells us you can ask. If someone has omitted to provide information, you can ask certain information, but you have to make sure that you comply with the general principles, which is effectively, if you allow it for one person, you allow it for all the others. And you have to have a reasonable period within which they have to give you that information. Contracting authorities have a very wide discretionary power in evaluating the tenders, but in case of a manifest error, loads of case law on that, in case of a manifest error, then the court will intervene. Failure, a manifest error, they won't. Article 84.4, absolutely important for you. There has to be a very important audit trail. Any decisions you make needs to be minuted. Any decisions you make in the evaluation needs to be in that folder, and it is often called a fear index for various reasons. So if you make a decision to use evaluation criteria, you must be clear why you use them. And ladies and gentlemen, I would advocate quite against standard forms of pre-QQs or SAQs, as they call them now. I advocate against it because contracting authorities believe that they have to tick all the boxes. And people are asking, contracting authorities are asking for certain criteria, not really knowing what they are asking or not really knowing whether this is important. And I'll come back to that in a minute. But evaluation team, in your fear index, you will have to specify who is going to be in your evaluation team and why you have chosen that person and that qualification of that person. Why did you choose that in your evaluation team? I'm currently involved in a public procurement dispute on vessels. And the whole issue was, what is a vessel? What are the licenses of the vessel? And the whole discussion was about that. However, who was in the evaluation team? Three people, civil servants, no idea about boats. So how can they evaluate? So the question will be, why did they decide to have those three people, if they have even written that down in their spec? So my advice always, when it comes to evaluation team of the evaluation criteria, or the selection criteria, or the award criteria, could be different teams, specify to people whom you will use in your evaluation team. I'm told I can't do that because if I mention the people, then they will be subject to certain approaches. The truth is, if they are subject to certain approaches, to call it that way, ladies and gentlemen, then they are not the right people for the evaluation team. Okay, so you need to think who you put in the evaluation team. Why? At the end, the evaluation team will have to explain the reasons why they chose one candidate over another. The reasons why they decided that one candidate was, for example, not financially strong. And I will give you an example of that now. What you see on the screen here is what we used in the Children's Hospital when it was still on the matter. You'll be glad to hear. We were trying to look at we had a whole strategy worked out about pass-fail criteria number one, then we see who stays over, then pass-fail number two, pass-fail number three, then we had a qualitative assessment and see who could best meet the criteria. And after that, which was unique, we had another pass-fail criteria, but this diagram showed that we would only pass six candidates. So if six candidates passed, but at the pass-fail they failed, we wanted to make sure that we were clear what would happen. Would number seven go forward with the six? Or would we simply go forward with five? That is the purpose of this diagram. Well thought through selection procedure, as you can see. In this particular case, we had to eliminate, and it was extremely difficult, a very well-known contractor. And we were put under huge pressure why we were not allowing that person to go forward. But the contracting authority, the evaluation team had assessed that they were not financially robust enough, and that shocked Ireland. 6 months later, that company went bust. The advantage of the system was that we didn't go through with a candidate that we could have awarded the contract to, and then eventually would not be able to do the job. So it works. Now, what are the hurdles we can have? Well, we have statutory exclusions, we have pass-fail criteria, and we have selection criteria. Those are the three. In the exclusions, they are all written in Article 57. There is a distinction. You have the mandatory exclusions. These, if someone falls in that category, has to be excluded, and the non-mandatory or the discretionary exclusions, the contracting authority can decide. You will understand when you look at the mandatory, you cannot select someone that has been convinced, and we need to have a final decision on that, very clear. In criminal organizations, someone that has been corrupt, been involved in fraud, terrorism offenses, anti-money laundering, breaching of tax and social security contributions. If you are in that situation, you cannot go forward. I'll come back to this. On the other hand, in the other exclusions, the contracting authority can make a discretion, but again, we'll have to establish and clarify what the position is. For example, if you went bankrupt, would that have an effect? If you were guilty of a grave professional misconduct, if there is a conflict of interest, which could be the situation whereby you've asked someone to help you with the tender and you feel that you can't bring that person to tender for the job because they have quite a lot of information. If you hadn't thought that through before you appointed them, what do you need to do? Do you need to exclude that person? Well, in the exclusions, it says you exclude if there is absolutely no other possibility. If there is another possibility that is less onerous, you can leave that person in, but you always have to consider what is in accordance with the principle of transparency, equality. Okay? Now, exclusion, one thing. But if you exclude, we now have this self-cleaning process. It's something very bizarre. It's the self-cleaning process is set out in Article 57.6, where a tenderer could say, yes, I was bold, yes, I did something that was wrong, but I have put measures in place that will make it, that will avoid this boldness going forward. So you have to explain what you put in place, and that was considered consistent with the proportionality principle. You will have heard of the European Single Procurement Document, the ESPD, always get it wrong. The ESPD is a standard self-declaration form through which a candidate will specify whether the exclusions apply to them or not, and if they do, what measures have they put in place to clean themselves from that past, that evil past. You have then discussions where should the contracting authority proactively seek that information, or should the tenderer proactively come up and say, sorry, I was a bold boy, but I'm a good boy now. And a Belgian case had to deal with this, and it went up to the European Court of Justice. It was called the Norrie Behagel case. And in that case, the discussion was this an obligation on the tenderer to proactively state that they were clean, or on the contracting authority to ask? The court, the European Court of Justice, stated in 2021 that if clearly stated that this is required, then the proactivity has to come from the tenderer. That's why it makes sense to use, as a contracting authority, the ESPD, because by putting the ESPD, you automatically have dealt with the exclusions, and the obligation is therefore on the tenderer. So not a bad thing. Pass-fail criteria. What are those? Well, the pass-fail criteria are a selection criterion that results in an automatic exclusion in the case of a failure, and it is expressly stated to be a pass-fail criteria. You have to be very careful with those, because if someone falls in the category, then that person is out. That's quite easy at the evaluation, at the debrief, to kick someone out and say, you didn't meet the objectively stated criteria, but you might exclude people that you might not want to exclude. For example, in the OGP had always required that consultants had to have a 6.5 million each and every claim. They've changed that now to a 6.5 million in the aggregate, only recently. But take lawyers, for example, like your good servant here. We have a minimum of 1.5 million. Now, you can have higher and higher, but 1.5 is what is required by the Law Society. So if you follow the OGP, you have to ask everybody to have a 6.5 million in the aggregate as it is now. But you've excluded all types of lawyers that could be very well and specialized. It is very hard to get the 6.5 million for a lawyer, because the view is that you should have 1.5. Same, for example, with fire consultants. Fire consultants cannot get more than 3 million, yet we are required, if you're tender, to have 6.5. People lie, that happens, but at the end you will be tested, and if you don't have it, based on the principle of equality, that person shouldn't be awarded the contract. So these are dangerous things to have. Insurance. The other is minimum turnover. How many times do I see a minimum turnover requirement that is higher, and the directive is very clear, it cannot be more than 2 years of the contract value. And in case of a framework, no more than 2 years of an anticipated income for the first year. Okay? People tick because they use those standard form and believe that that's the right thing to do. Turnover, you might not put or need a turnover requirement, but people do because they feel they have to tick the standard form, hence my reaction against the standard forms. We have had the exclusions, we have had the pass-fail, and pass-fail could be all types of things. They have to be clearly stated. We now go to the selection criteria. Now, in the selection criteria, you have really minimum, you can't go over those 3 points. One is the suitability to pursue a professional activity. You're looking for an architect, you want the architect to be a member of the Order of the Architects, or the RII, or equivalent in other countries. That is a perfectly acceptable requirement, more often expressed as a pass-fail than as a selection criteria. The real criteria are economic and financial standing. You're entitled to dig into the financial history of the person, or technical and professional ability. You're looking at whether this person has the ability, the experience to do the job. Warning. If you ask documents, in the tender documents, you need to do something with it. Don't ask something you do nothing with. And financial and economical standard is atypical. You're asked for financial documents. Ask yourself the question first. The person that will be in the evaluation team, will that person be able to understand what those documents say? I can't. That's why I did law. But I did law because I don't like maths. So here is the same. If you are asking financial documents of a company, you have to make sure that you can understand it. And don't do what some contracting authorities do. They say, we ask because it looks good. And then afterwards, we give everybody the same mark. That's a waste of time. And my kids keep telling me, we have to think of the trees that are killed by having all those papers put forward to you. If you don't do anything with it, don't ask. You won't be judged on it. In fact, it would be better that you don't ask it. Technical and professional ability. It's all about experience. What does experience has that person? What can he or she do? You could do what is done a lot in pass-fail criteria. You could perfectly say, I want you to have 3 reference projects. That is a pass-fail. And then afterwards, I want you to, and I will evaluate you on it, on the other experiences that you have. Now, be careful. If you ask reference projects, then you need to be clear what you're looking for. For example, you want experience in having worked on a hospital. So what is the hospital? Are we talking about the experience in acute hospitals or not? What is important for you, you specify and articulate, because you're going to let people pass and others will be excluded if you articulate it as a pass-fail requirement. In the case of experience, you might say, that's okay, we'll cover it through experience, but what is important for you in the evaluation team? Is it the fact that you can do big projects? For example, the fact that you have done the children's hospital, does that make you therefore score higher? Or do you say, no, I'm not really interested in those big projects. I'm really interested in the small projects, small little things. And I've had evaluation team members telling my client, we thought you were very good, but you were good for the big things, not for the small things. Ladies and gentlemen, if it's not stated in the evaluation team paperwork, then you cannot make that argument, because that argument was not communicated. You need to be very clear what you evaluate. And I come back to the essence of constantly thinking of the key principles of procurement, which is equality, transparency, and proportionality. Think about those when you make them and say, is this proportionate to what I'm asking? For example, is it proportionate to ask for a 50 million PI level of the legal sector? The answer might be yes, because we want to have a top 5 firm. Fine, that is a decision. But not, I do 50 because someone whispered that in my ear. You then have to question yourself, who is that someone? Is that someone that could influence the procurement? If so, that person should sign a conflict of no interest paper. So all those things constantly play. In the animated movie of Disney, the movie called Luca, which is another movie than the Encanto, Alberto tells Luca, listen, you should not listen to that inner voice of reason. Switch him off. You can't do this, you can't do that, don't. So he says, switch that voice off. And he calls, quite unfortunately, that voice Bruno. So Bruno is the inner voice. Listen to this and I'll conclude.
Silencio, Bruno!
Silencio, Bruno!
Silencio, Bruno!
Silencio, Bruno!
Can you still hear it?
Nope, just you!
Good! Now hang on!
and off they go down the cliff. They just said, let's try this Vespa. We made it ourselves. Let's try. Needless to say that they crash in the water afterwards. You can't do that, ladies and gentlemen. When you're doing public procurement, you constantly have to think, what would Bruno, my inner voice of reason, say? The inner voice of reason is what I hope you have understood from my message. Bruno means the principles of procurement, the fundamental principle of procurement, equality, transparency, and proportionality to the subject matter of the project. You're going to say, I knew this. The truth is, do you? Do you listen to that voice when you do the public procurement? If you do, then this was wasted on you. But if you don't, which I think many don't, because that's how I make a living, for a lot of people not listening to Bruno, then you have a problem. Ladies and gentlemen, word to remember is ascolta Bruno. Listen to Bruno, your inner voice of reason. Thank you.